Hey guys, CP Jason here. We're going to be talking about law and self-defense, things that you absolutely need to know about self-defense, the way the law looks at it, not just the way your gym or your school or your martial art looks at it. Before we get into that, please click the like and subscribe button. We love the support. We really appreciate it. And it would, be really good if you did that. If not, I hate to threaten you, but something bad and weird will happen to you. Your girlfriend, she'll make up her mind what she wants to eat. All right. It's a terrible joke. Anyway, what do you want to go to eat? I don't know. What do you want to go to eat? That whole thing. Now she'll make up her mind. You're going to hate it and you're going to be stuck. And you told her to make up her mind. You asked her where she wanted to go, so now you can't complain. So do the right thing. Like and subscribe. All right. Law and self-defense. Listen, this is a subject that needs to be first and foremost in every martial art education, because if you're going to be in a physical altercation, there's going to be legal consequences to it, right? I mean, we're not 10 years old having a fight in the playground. So if you're an adult, these are the things you have to consider. Number one, you have to understand self-defense, the way the law looks at it, at least in America and in most states, is that you have to be able to prove that any reasonable person would have done the same thing you did under the circumstances. Okay, so you can't talk your way into a fight. So you have to prove, one, you had a right to be where you were. Obviously, if you're over at somebody's house and they're being a jerk, and you guys get in a shouting match with each other over who's the best college football team or something like that, and he says, get out, and then you guys get into a fight, you didn't have a legal right to be there. So you getting into a fight there is going to be a very bad idea for you legally. Okay, so you have to have a legal right to be there. Number two, you had to have taken some type of step or had been unable to take some type of evasive action to avoid the confrontation. This is an enormously important point, because there was a case of the Boston hockey dad a number of years ago. I covered this in one of my books, that this guy's kid was playing hockey and this other kid was being a real bully and a real jerk on the ice. And so there were words between the dads. The dad then gets the gear with his son, leaves the hockey rink, and then his son forgot something. This hockey stuff, apparently, is like really expensive stuff. So he goes, well, forget that. I'm not going to leave it there. So he goes back in to get the stuff. There's another confrontation, and this one turns physical. And a way of looking at this is a conflict is not a fight. All fights were conflicts, but not all conflicts have to be fights. So you're going to think your way through that. He goes back in there, and now there's another, it escalates. He punches the guy. Guy falls, hits his head, he's dead. In Massachusetts, they charge that guy, and the guy did time for manslaughter because he claimed self-defense, but the law reasoned that, and I think wrongly, but this is what happened, that if he was really in fear of this guy, he should have stayed away. He shouldn't have gone back into the facility. Incidentally, it was found out later, it was reported, that the guy that died had actually been convicted of beating a tar out of somebody a few years before that and actually did time for it and a whole bit, but that wasn't brought up to the jury. So if you're sitting there at home going, I'm not taking no crap from nobody, we're talking about serious issues here that can come and really ruin your life if you're not paying attention. So please pay attention to that. So you've got to have a reason to be there. You have to have done everything you could to avoid the fight. If it looks like you tried to get into a fight, there's any kind of fighting words that you use, especially today, everybody's got their iPhones out and they're filming you. If you go, you don't know who you're messing with. And then there's a physical altercation. And you beat the guy. You could be held accountable for that because you were, if not the aggressor, you were at least a willing participant. And it's not legal to be a willing participant in a violent encounter. So those things said, you then lead, let's say the fight starts. Let's say you've done everything right, you tried to get away, you've been a gentleman and so forth and so on, and then you're still unlucky, you get into a fight. And bang, let's say you hit the guy, the fight's over, and the police show up. Now, what should you say? Right? You certainly do not want to say, the guy was a jerk and he had it coming. I hit him with my big straight left hand, he's down like a blankety blank, crying like a blankety blank, That's not going to go over well, because you're going to be writing all that stuff down. And if someone wants to prosecute you, that will come up. So you have to calm down and you have to be able to give an articulate, you have to be able to articulate the reason you defended yourself. Preferably, I think you should probably talk to a lawyer if you're worried about this. It's natural for everybody wanting to explain themselves. That's what we do. Somebody accuses you of something, you want to explain yourself. Well, the problem with that is that if you could get charged for something you say, my suggestion would be if you are in a fight, you have to defend yourself, please show up. If you have a lawyer, let them talk to your lawyer, okay? The only thing you should say is, you know, I was trying to get away. I was in fear for my safety. I was just trying to keep the guy off of me. Repeat. I was afraid of him. I was trying to get away. I was trying to keep him off of me. Repeat. I'll talk to my lawyer, okay? Don't give him a blow-by-blow, you know, like you were, you know, talk about Bruce Lee and Under the Dragon in a whole bit, and don't do that. It's not gonna sound very good legally. It's gonna seem to them that you are looking for trouble. Which then brings me to the next point. Don't walk around with a shirt on that says something bombastic and something truculent and something, you know, something like, you know, I fear no man, or it's just a photo of somebody beating the crap out of somebody on it. That is not the photo that you want the jury to see. Well, I was just trying to defend myself. And they're gonna show you standing there, right, with this dumb shirt on. So funny though it might be, don't put a shirt on or wear something in public, especially if you're a trained martial artist, because then it's even worse, a trained martial artist. It's worse to have a violent message that you walking billboard. And it's very easy these days, and I can't tell you enough how a few people have actually been in altercations that they didn't start, and the judge let the guy off because it was found out that the person they were in the altercation with had some martial arts training, and there were some photos of them looking like, you know, looking like barbarians, and they said, well, I don't think you were afraid of that guy. And so some of it's subjective. I'm sorry, don't blame me for it. I'm just trying to give you the heads up and things that you should consider. Because if you do win the fight and you end up beating the guy and then you end up in jail, I would say that's kind of like a win, big lose. So you want a win-win. And it goes to show you that no one ever wins a fight. You have nothing to gain from being in a fight. So always do the right thing. Always be polite, be respectful. And if there's any sign of danger, leave. Okay, just get out of there. Your ego, that could be a problem. You know, and lastly with the whole thing, as far as the law and self-defense is concerned, you have obviously a God-given right to defend yourself. And yet, once that starts, as soon as the threat has been defeated or thwarted and there's no longer an imminent threat to you or to your loved ones, you need to cease your counteroffensive. If for example, let's say you're an MMA guy and you know, you shoot for a double leg and you start hitting this guy and he's kind of down and you keep hitting him, you've now gone from the defender to the attacker. You need to break off your attack the very minute his attack is no longer a threat to you. That's the way the law looks at it. There's been a lot of cases where, because of ground and pound, where people got shot. There was a very famous case in Florida several years ago, and one guy, you know, took the other guy down, and the guy getting pounded on the ground shot the guy, and, you know, so he said he was in fear for his life because he got a guy sitting on him, pounding on him, and that was it. Did that really happen? We don't know, because one of those two participants, and one of them was dead. And so the injuries the survivor had were consistent with the story, so he walked. You know, so you gotta make sure that your counterattack tactics are commensurate with the threat that you're facing, right? You know, if you're a JKD guy, you shove a guy, kick him in the knee, his knee buckles, get out of there. You know, don't go Bruce Lee, Bob Wall, and jump in the air and land on the guy, right? You know, even if he did kill your sister. So I would leave that to the government, leave that to 911. So don't do something excessive in your defense. That's a problem, okay? So all of that said, hopefully it will help you stay out of the kind of trouble that too many people have fallen into. You know, you can look around on the internet and you can find a lot of stories of people who were in fights and ended up in big legal trouble for it. One bonus thing, if you do defend yourself with a weapon, if you carry a concealed handgun or you have a knife and you deploy that weapon, obviously all of this is really just elevated in a heartbeat. So you're now using a lethal weapon. So you have to be even more steadfast in the way you conduct yourself. There was a case in Florida, another one in Florida. A lot of people moved to Florida, and I don't think they're right in the head. But I'm sure there's fine people in Florida. Bad joke. But it's usually in America. If you're depending on where you're watching this from, when really stupid news hits, most of us here in America go, before we know where it was. If it was really weird, we think it was Florida or California, one of the two. If it was really violent, sometimes we think Texas, but Florida or California come to mind first. This guy, he gets out of his car, he sees a car at a convenience store, and he sees a car parked in a handicapped spot. And he's enraged. He's, he goes over there and he says, giving this woman the what for. Well, the woman's boyfriend comes out of a store and like this idiot guy is shouting at his girlfriend, so he shoves him and knocks the guy down. Think what you want of that. I don't think that was necessary. You know, I think you should, probably should have just told the guy to go away. But anyway, shoves him, knocks him down. Well, then the guy starts walking away. He shoves him, starts walking away. The guy on the ground pulls his concealed handgun, shoots him, kills him, right in front of his child and his girlfriend, or I think it was his girlfriend or wife. He gets charged with murder, and he's convicted, I think, rightly. The guy was walking away from him. He was not in fear of his life. But these are the kind of things you can make a decision in a moment, in a fraction of a second, and it can cause all sorts of havoc. So if you don't think about these things beforehand and have them as a regular part of your training, you're not really doing martial arts. Okay? You're not really doing martial arts. You're doing UFC, you're doing boxing, whatever it is you're doing, those are fine disciplines, but they're not martial arts. Those are martial sports. You need to think about these things because if you need them, there are going to be consequences. Okay? There are going to be consequences. So hope all of this helped. If you have any questions, let us know. And leave some wonderful and brilliant comments below. We'd love to hear from you. We do thank you for all of your support. It means a lot to us. And remember, our goal is to help keep you safe. Our goal is to teach you self-defense and martial arts as best we can through this medium, because this information, I think, should be out there, and it should be for everybody, right? And a lot of us haven't really had that chat with dad. Some of you guys, maybe you didn't have a dad that sat you down and said, listen, son, you know, this is what you need to hear about fighting, and this is what you need to hear about the world. You know, if you get pulled over by a cop, things to do, not to do, that kind of thing. So, I mean, there's a lot of, like, confusion out there, so we're trying to bridge that gap for you, all right? So, hope this helped. Again, C3 Jason, Greenville Academy of Martial Arts. If you're in the beautiful Greenville area, stop in. We have a wonderful and gorgeous downtown, but I will tell you right away, you can't move here because too many people here. Traffic's driving me nuts. So, if I'm stuck in traffic, I'm not doing these videos, and then what are you going to do? You have to find some other channel to watch, and that's bad for both of us. So anyway, having fun here, and thanks for watching. We'll catch you next time.